Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
And welcome to St. Peter's this morning. It's lovely to see you. And welcome back if you've not been for a few weeks. It's really great to have you back with us. Welcome to those watching online this morning, wherever you are. We continue our sermon series this Lent, looking at the book of Exodus, Redemption Dawns. And we'll be looking at a very famous incident towards the beginning of the book of Exodus, Moses at the burning bush. And we'll be looking at that. In here, so grown-ups, and I think the little ones looking at that as well. Yeah, the little ones are doing the same in Sunday Club at the back this morning as well. Let's begin in praise and worship, and the band are going to be singing a couple of songs for us, so I'm going to hand over to them. Please stand.
Steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. There are some really wonderful words to kind of hang on to, the truths that are ours in Christ and what he's done for us.
can sing it properly, won't it? It's a great song, fantastic song. To this I hold, is repeated throughout the song. My sins be defeated, the shepherd will defend me. My hope is in only Jesus, yet not I, but through Christ in me. We're going to come to that bit of the service where we acknowledge our need for Christ, our hope, the one who sets us free from our sin, as we say sorry to him. I'm going to use some words from Psalm 27 as the basis of our confession today. Psalm 27. Let's pray. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evil men advance against me to devour my flesh, when my enemies and my foes attack, they will stumble. One thing I ask, Lord, this is what I seek, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. And so as we seek you, gracious, loving Heavenly Father, today, we thank you for the forgiveness we have offered to us in Christ your Son, who died in our place, that we might be forgiven. So we thank you that he has given us that stronghold in which we can stand today, knowing that in and through him, the slate has been wiped clean, and that we could be in your presence forever for your glory's sake. For we pray in his name. Amen. Salvation belongs to our God.
Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock. came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face, because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of the land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, What is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, Say to the Israelites, The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name by which I am to be remembered from generation to generation. Go, assemble the elders of Israel, and say to them, The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared to me and said, I have watched over you and have seen what has been done to you in Egypt, and I have promised to bring you up out of your misery in Egypt into the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites, a land flowing with milk and honey. This is the word of the Lord.
Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, indeed the power of your resurrection, the resurrection of your Son Jesus, lives in us. May we know that resurrection power a little more fully as we look at this most wonderful of Old Testament passages. We've all got a picture in our minds, probably of a burning bush. And Lord, we pray now that you would, and as you spoke to Moses, speak to us. As we've heard your word and hear it explained now, that we would go from here, fired up, changed and transformed. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So do keep that open, page 90 in the big black Bibles. I don't know the page number in the other ones, but it's a second book of the Bible, chapter 3. Verses 1 to 17. Well, I wonder if you've ever had the experience of arriving somewhere at night, perhaps on holiday, remember those? And you know when you get there, you know there's an amazing view out there, out of the window. Maybe that's the reason why you're on holiday in this particular area, because of the scenery. But because of the dark, you've arrived at night, you can't see it. I'm reminded of travelling to the Alps to go skiing. I've been a few times. Often when you go to the Alps because of the distance, you usually arrive after dark, at night, after a long journey, and you get out of the bus and you stand in the car park outside the chalet and you gaze into the blackness, or you gaze out of the window of your particular hotel room or whatever it might be. The air is tantalisingly cold. Snow lies around your feet. There's a sense of vastness and a vague outline of enormous mountains against the starry sky. But you cannot apprehend what's there because of the dark. You know immensity and greatness are just there. Almost, you can almost touch it. It's all around you. It's why you've come, but you're going to have to wait. Lying in bed, not able to sleep, you just long for the morning when glory awaits as you pull the curtains back. For now we see through a glass darkly, wrote the Apostle Paul to the church at Corinth. I think this is one of the hardest aspects of knowing the Lord and following him. For as much as we can know and enjoy the Lord through faith in Christ and the presence of his Holy Spirit with us, we know that God has spoken fully and finally to us in his Son, Hebrews chapter 1. Despite all that light, we still see through a glass darkly, don't we? It's as though God is like a vast mountainscape that we know surrounds us all the time. He is with us, we know that. And yet he remains veiled in semi-darkness as well. It's just the way it is. Because of our earthiness as human beings, because of our sinfulness, because of our distance from the perfection of Eden. It's just the way it is on this long walk of our discipleship on the road to the new Eden of heaven. And that feels disappointing, doesn't it? Let's just be honest about that. Feels disappointing. It's really hard to behold the glory of God in day-to-day life when actually he feels veiled quite a lot of the time. It's as though we've arrived, knowing he's there, but it's dark. Except actually, there's a theme in Scripture though, and it's very present here in Exodus chapter 3, that it's actually a good thing that God is veiled on our side of eternity. Otherwise, creatures like you and me, well, we'd be completely undone, wouldn't we? We'd unravel in his presence. We'd turn to jelly in his awesome unveiled presence. Because that's what happens to Moses at the burning bush. It's Isaiah's experience and reaction when he sees the Lord in the temple. In Isaiah chapter 6, woe to me, I am ruined. That's what he says when he sees the Lord, Isaiah 6. But surely the main teaching point from the few times in the Bible when God shows up in unveiled glory, surely the main teaching point is that we would behold his glory, a greater vision of him from our side of the curtain. That now in the semi-gloom of our daily existence, when we read of Jacob wrestling with the angel, for instance, or the burning bush, as we read today, or the pillars of cloud and of fire in later in Exodus, or the transfiguration of Christ in the Gospels, or the various resurrection appearances, we'll get to those after Easter, or John's vision of heaven in the book of Revelation, a lamb seated on the throne. That's like the first sunlight, isn't it? Catching the tops of the mountains in the morning. Well, when we have those moments in Scripture, I think we are supposed to go, wow. And we need those wow moments, don't we? We need to know his vastness, his greatness, his glory. Otherwise, the God of our daily discipleship is just, well, he ends up a rather kind of lowly, limited version of who he really is. Sometimes when we, in our daily experience, we see someone come to Christ for the first time. Or we see some miracle happen, you know, a healing or some miraculous provision. Or in worship, or in nature, or in a dream, or in some other particular experience that we have of God, we do sense his greatness and his glory. We get those moments, don't we, at times. But often God is rather reduced, isn't he? It's a rather kind of God redux in our daily walk with him. And perhaps actually these last few months, perhaps it's a particular problem that this reduction of God, this rather lowly and limited version of him that we have in our mind's eye, perhaps that's especially a problem at the moment. Well, I think this is a good passage for us if that's the case for you. Moses, says the Lord from the fire in the bush. Do not come any closer, take off your shoes, holy ground, he says. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And at this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. And then God says to him, I am who I am. Remember, we've been learning over these last couple of weeks about how God is true to his promises, compassionate in his covenant love for his people who are in slavery in Egypt. But he is hatching a plan, isn't he? A plan to rescue them so that they will be his people, living in his land, under his rule and blessing. If we could flick forward a couple of slides, we'll see that slide. It gives us kind of the background of where we are. Next one, there we go. Is that one? Yes. If you're kind of wondering what the middle picture is, I think it's a beard, isn't it? I think I only worked that out after I'd used it for at least a week. Because of course all the patriarchs had beards, didn't they? Well, anyway, then maybe they did. So we're learning about how God is hatching a plan to put his people, to make them a people, to live with them in his land, that they would live under his rule and blessing. God's covenant with Abraham, Genesis 12. And he longs to dwell with them again. Hence all the stuff about the law and the tabernacle in the rest of Exodus. That they, his people, would be blessed and that they would share that blessing with the world around them. Often, sadly, that didn't happen. And in his gracious sovereignty, God has been preparing a leader for his people to make all this happen. Moses, who was rescued in God's grace out of the bulrushes of the Nile by the courage of his mother and his sister. We thought about that last week. Moses is then erased as a prince of Egypt, hence the title of the Disney movie, with a burden to help his captive countrymen, though. But as we heard last week, he ends up far away, hundreds of miles away, down the Arabian Peninsula in Midian. He has to flee. But there he ends up getting married, and now he's looking after his father-in-law's sheep. Brief aside, leadership and shepherding always go together in the Bible, always go together in God's world. Leadership and shepherding. And now God addresses his servant Moses from the non-burning burning bush, commissioning him for a unique role that he will have in this great plan of redemption that he is enacting. Verse 7 of our reading, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned for their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians, says God, from the bush, and to bring them out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, and all the otherites. It's on, isn't it? It's on. The great rescue epic of the Old Testament is about to start. The one that prefigures the great rescue epic of the New Testament. Christ dying on a cross and rising again for us. Indeed, actually, God's great rescue epic of all creation is foreshadowed here in the book of Exodus. Namely, the one to rescue you and me. And all creation out of its bondage, not to the Egyptians, but out of our bondage to sin and decay and death, that we might live for God and with God to his praise and glory. Can you see the echoes of that in Exodus? The echoes of the big story that is beginning to unfold. And in every heart that he has made, yours and mine included, this rescue plan is played out, isn't it? A rescue that continues to this day. But before we get to absorbed in the really exciting stuff in the book of Exodus, the plagues and the Passover and the Red Sea, and we're going to come to that in the next few weeks. It's vital here, and I think this is the lesson for in Exodus 3, that we get absorbed in God himself. We make sure that we're tuned in to him, the great hero of the redemption story, the one who enacts it all, in whom we are inclined to domesticate, rather, aren't we, in our personal experience of him, to kind of dumb him down a bit. To reduce him. The great I am. I am whom I am, says the Lord, from the non-burning, burning bush. Remember, there was a time when Jesus took those words on his lips too. Truly I say to to you before Abraham was, I am, said Jesus. John 8:58. And they picked up stones to throw at him. But before Moses is ready to leave, he needs to realize how great God is. That's the point here. God needs to show Moses his greatness. So let's have the same question asked of us today. Have you realized how great God is? Have you realized how great he is? Or do you need to realize again how great he is? God has explained to Moses from the bush what he's going to do, as we heard in our reading. But Moses then asked God for some ID. Isn't that extraordinary? He IDs God. It's a rather odd exchange, actually, to our ears. Moses is clearly immediately unsettled by the whole experience, which is not surprising in some respects. He's unsettled a bit like Peter was unsettled at the Transfiguration. And, you know, I don't know about you, but when I'm unsettled, I tend to ask silly questions and say stupid things. And that's kind of what Moses does here, isn't it? A bit like Peter, Transfiguration also. And so verse 11 of our reading, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" says Moses. "Well, I'll be with you," says God, "and I'll give you a sign. Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' Well, then what shall I say?" It's a bit of an odd question, isn't it? "There's a bush on fire, but it's not being consumed, and there's a voice coming out of the fire, and Moses is concerned for ID." He's asking God for ID. Has he not realized how great God is? Has he had God on a shelf, in a box, maybe? Has he reduced him? Has he domesticated him a little? There is a particular aspect in the context, at the time, that is kind of live here in this situation with the burning bush, which is that actually the gods of the ancient world at that time usually had quite elaborate names. And so the name of God was kind of quite an important thing. You know, Baal, Molech, Asherah, and all the various Egyptian gods of the time. And so that's probably partly why Moses wants a name. Clearly Moses, though, is also just not quite grasped the magnitude of the situation. An extraordinary greatness of the one who is addressing him from a bush that is raging as a fire, but yet still is living and carries on living afterwards, presumably. And so what does God do? He blasts him with some godness, doesn't he? That's what he does to Moses. "I am who I am." The great self-identification of God in the Old Testament. The words are quite hard to translate. They are, "I am who I am," but they are also, "I will be who I will be." And so the point is here, it's not a matter of names, Moses. It's my being that matters. It's my existence that matters. God is saying to Moses, "God is, I am." He is the fact, isn't he? He is fact 1.0. Of all facts, he is the first fact. He is the most fundamental reality. "In the beginning, God," says the first verse of the Bible. Of all the facts in the universe, just think of all the facts that we know, just amongst us here. Just think of all the facts that you've learned on your quizzes in these last few months. I've learned a lot of really useless facts. But the first and foremost fact is this fact: God is. That is the only fact that stands alone, with no, doesn't need any reference to any other facts. God is, I am whom I am. The Bible's account of God is that God is. It's not the sum total of the Bible's account of God. There's lots more to say, of course there is. But that's the most fundamental one. God is. He is the ultimate reality, the absolute reality, the reality from which all other reality is derived. No beginning, no end. Constant, truthful, righteous, gracious, loving. God is in his glorious vastness. And so the only thing I could kind of draw on is mountains, the massiveness of mountains, to try and help us grasp this today. And so Moses, you, me, all the world, in fact, have we realised how great God is? Or has he gone a bit like that, been reduced rather? Because no, we don't realise how great he is. We never could we? We don't, we haven't. We catch glimpses at times in creation, in the wonder of the human beings around us that are made in his image. Yes, we see the greatness of God in Christ, and we know him by the truth of his word and the power of his spirit dwelling in us. Yes, amen to all of that. But even Moses standing here in the presence of God, barefoot, even he is struggling to apprehend the greatness of the one speaking to him out of the non-burning, burning bush. I guess after this experience, he was kind of on the way, wasn't he? Reassured that God is incomprehensibly great and he will encounter him again at Sinai, of course. I am who I am. I am has sent me to you, he's to say to the Israelites. And that word I am, Yahweh, ends up being in the rest of the Bible. The Lord, usually in capital letters in your Old Testament, because that's how it's best configured in the translation. Now, whether you've been following the Lord for ages or just perhaps beginning to consider him properly for the first time, seeking his greatness and beholding our great God, that is vital for our discipleship. At times, our minds must go, wow, at him. And I think that's the point here. But three aspects of his greatness that I think are particularly are apparent in this passage. And the first one is God is great in his holiness. Do not come any closer, he says to Moses. Don't come any closer. Stand 2 meters away. Do not cross this line. Remove your shoes. The bush, the ground around the bush is alive with godness, isn't it? Hence the removing of shoes. Moses hides his face because he's afraid to look at God. This is how holy God is, how set apart he is from all that he has made, how other he is from the universe he's created, blazing in his perfection and beauty. Suddenly, Moses is encountering someone truly out of this world, and not just out of this world, out of this creation. God is great in his holiness. And you know that rather domesticated, user-friendly God of your imagination? It's always a less holy version than the real version, isn't it? You know, than the real God. You know, less holy so that he will conveniently overlook my sin. Less holy so I don't have to take him seriously all the time. Less holy so I can blow hot and cold with him. It doesn't really matter. Well, it does matter. That's why he sent his son to die in our place, because it matters so much. No, he is white hot in his holiness, isn't he? That is the picture of God here, as the bush burns but is not consumed. A picture that is redrawn in other ways multiple times throughout the Bible. God is great in his holiness. Second, God is great in his compassion. I mean, he could have left them in Egypt, couldn't he? Actually. Except he could not leave them in Egypt because of the contract. Remember that? The covenant that he had made to bless them and put them in his land, Genesis chapter 12. It's not just that he's contractually obliged. He is passionately obliged. Compassionately obliged. He is generous, merciful, kind. This is from the heart as well as on paper. God is great in his compassion. He's made a promise. He's going to keep it. And so verse 7 of our reading, the Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. He sees, he's heard, he's concerned, or he has compassion on their suffering. That gives amazing shape and reality and fullness, doesn't it, to the notion that you and I will probably be very familiar with but we so often doubt, which is that God is good. He is really good. He loves us. He is compassionate. He is kind. I mean, contrast him with Pharaoh here, who's the other, you know, kind of big power in the story, although no power at all, really, compared to God. Because at that particular moment, he's masquerading as God for the Israelites. They've got to do what he says. But what is he like? He's cruel. He's tyrannical. He's heartless. He is ruthless. No wonder God, in his compassion, is going to rescue them from him. And yet in our darker moments, when it comes to us, we often shrink from this reality that God is good. We think he's kind of partially good, or good to other people. He just isn't very good to me, seems to be our domesticated, reduced version that we settle for so often. He's marginally good, moderately good, missed me off his list, good. No, God is great, God is good. He is great in his compassion. Return to the Lord your God, writes the prophet Joel, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He is great in his compassion. Third, finally, it is out of that reality that the third reality of his greatness comes. God is great in his blessing, isn't he? He loves and longs to bless, and we see that here. And what he promises will be the case for his people, as he promises to Moses. Go assemble the elders of Israel, he says to Moses in verse 16, and say to them, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared to me and said, I have watched over you and have seen what they've done to you in Egypt. I have promised to bring you out of your misery in Egypt to the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, and all the otherites, to a land flowing with what? Milk and honey. Milk and honey, you've probably got both at home, haven't you? A land flowing with it, though, not just a jar of it and a bottle of it. A land flowing with it. What? Why milk and honey? Because they didn't have that in Egypt, that's the point. I mean, Egypt had grain and shelter and water, for a time at least, for the people. But they didn't have milk and honey there. That's the whole point. That's the blessing of God, the promised land, which is going to take, it's going to take a long time. But that's the blessing that awaits. Milk and honey, not currency and fossil fuels. The milk and honey of our day to day. Not terabytes and data. Not medicine and vaccines, but milk and honey. Sustenance, and the very best of sustenance as well. Wholesome milk, sweet honey. Not available in Egypt to them. See, when God blesses, it's good. It is Eden-like in its beauty and its fruitfulness. This is God's place where he will dwell with them in glory, the promised land to come, and it's a picture of the promised land of Eden, heaven, that you and I look forward to with Christ. So have you realized how great God is? Well, we get a glimpse of it here. In this wonderful story of the non-burning, burning bush. In his holiness, in his compassion, in his blessing, have you realized how great God is, or have you deconstructed him, reduced him, got him on redux in your heart and mind at the moment? Veiled in the semi-darkness as we plod through the humdrum of life, which we're all doing, we need to realize again how great he is. And the best way to do that is to look at Jesus. Look at him, for in him we see God's greatness unveiled. Let's pray. We praise you today, even though we can't do it with voices and the way that we would love to. Nevertheless, Lord, we praise you for your goodness and mercy and greatness and power. You are great in power. You are King of all the earth. And so in these days when life feels so restricted and humdrum, us a fresh vision of your greatness, we pray. That you might be honoured and glorified, that we would live our lives in that light. Help us, we pray, as we live in this veiled semi-darkness, to nevertheless behold your glory, particularly in the person of your Son, Jesus. For we pray, in his name and for his glory. Amen. Let's hold those thoughts in our mind's eye as we hear the final song. We'd love to join in, but well, you can in your heart at least. Great in power, great in glory, great in mercy, King of heaven. Shall we stand? Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise him. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel, heals the brokenhearted, and binds up their wounds. And so, Lord, keep that vision of your greatness in our hearts and minds as we go into this week with changes for families, for school, with all that we've got to keep going with at this moment in time, with restrictions, perhaps some of the humdrum of this pandemic continuing for many of us, probably for all of us in one way or another. Lord, keep that vision of your greatness in our hearts and minds. That you would be glorified. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us this day, this Lent, and remain with us always. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, hello. All got one to take home as well with you. Do you want to show those? I'll hold them up so everyone can see.
Oh, wow.
Brilliant. There we go. I think the trouble is if we said light to that, I think it probably would go, wouldn't it? Yeah. Well, thank you, and that's brilliant that you've been able to do that this morning, and it gives a lovely visual reminder of what we've been thinking about in here as well, as the grown-ups. What are you pointing at, sorry?
To say thank you to Wes.
Oh, and thank you to Wes. But I think he had quite a lot of fun too. Excellent. I think that's a lovely way to conclude our service, isn't it?